Welcome again to the Engineering Chemistry course. Before starting the today's class, let's have the recap of the previous class. In the last class, we have discussed about the determination of calorific value, in which we have discussed that calorific value of fuel may be determined by experimental methods or by theoretical methods. In experimental methods, we have discussed two types of calorimeters, bomb calorimeter and the Junkers calorimeter. While in the theoretical determination, Dulong formula is used to determine the calorific value of the fuel. In the last class, we have discussed about the determination of calorific value by bomb's calorimeter in detail, in which we have learned about the construction of bomb calorimeter, its working, observation, and calculations, and the corrections in the final formula we derived in the bomb's calorimeter. That's all for the previous class we have learned about. In today's class, we are going to discuss about the determination of calorific value by Junkers calorimeter, in which construction of Junkers calorimeter, its working, and observation and calculation in Junkers calorimeter we will discuss. After that, we are going to discuss the determination of calorific value by Joulenc's formula, that is the theoretical determination of the calorific value. So, let us begin with the determination of calorific value by Junkers calorimeter. As in the in our previous class, we have discussed that Junkers calorimeter is specifically used for the determination of calorific value of the gaseous fuels and the volatile liquid fuels. So first of all, we must know which type of fuel can be determined through the Junkers calorimeter. So we can determine the calorific value of the gaseous fuel and the volatile liquid fuel by the Junkers calorimeter. This is the construction of the Junkers calorimeter. Before starting, let's have the look to the main parts of the Junkers calorimeter: Bunsen burner, gasometer, pressure governor, and the gas calorimeter. Now look at the figure here. This is the main part, which is called the Bunsen burner. This is the Bunsen burner. Second one is the gasometer with pressure governor. This is gasometer with the pressure governor. This second part is the second and third part are the gasometer and the pressure governor, and fourth part is the gas calorimeter. This is the gas calorimeter part. So this is the construction of Junkers calorimeter, in which one is the gas calorimeter here. This is the gas calorimeter, which is surrounded by the outer jacket, which prevents the heat loss from the calorimeter. So this is the chromium plated outer jacket, which prevents the heat loss. At the center of the calorimeter, there is a hole in which knob of the Bunsen burner is present. This is the Bunsen burner. Now, the Bunsen burner is the special type of gas burner which is clamped at the bottom, from this side at the bottom, and can be easily pulled out from the combustion chamber or pushed up into it during the performance of the experiment. This is adjustable knob. So this is the Bunsen burner. This Bunsen burner is connected with the gasometer, which gasometer is then connected with the pressure governor. So gasometer is this device. This is the gasometer. It measures the volume of gas burning per unit time. The gas is allowed. What is gas here? Gas is the gaseous fuel. The gas is allowed to burn after passing through the gasometer. So definite amount of gaseous fuel is passed through this gasometer to the Bunsen burner. A thermometer with a manometer is also attached to it, with the gasometer to it, for reading the temperature and pressure of the gas before use, here, which is not shown here. This is the gasometer. This gasometer is then connected with the pressure governor. What is the role of pressure governor here? The pressure governor controls the pressure of the gas passed into the Bunsen burner. So, gasometer actually controls the volume or the amount of gaseous fuel which burns into the Bunsen burner, and while the pressure governor controls its pressure, right? And Bunsen burner allows the space or allows to pathway to the gaseous fuel to burn into the combustion chamber of the gas calorimeter. Clear? Now, this part is the gas calorimeter. It consists of a vertical chamber. This is the gas calorimeter vertical chamber. It contains interconnecting tube known as the flues. These are the interconnecting tubes. These known as the flues. The chamber is surrounded. This chamber is surrounded by an annular water heating space. This is the annular water heating space. This is the water heating space and heat exchange coils. There is one inlet and one outlet for the water supply. This is the inlet of water supply, where the initial water is supplied and initial temperature is noted down, that is the T1 degree centigrade, and this is the outlet of the water. At this, the thermometer is placed which noted down the final temperature, that is the T2 degree centigrade. So these are the initial and final temperature readings. The whole apparatus is surrounded by an outer jacket. This is the outer jacket which is chromium plated to reduce the heat losses from the calorimeter by radiations. The annular water heating space is connected at its bottom end at a constant water head to ensure uniform rate of circulation of water. This ensures the uniform rate of circulation of water through these flues. So this is the construction of the Junkers calorimeter. Once again, I am repeating, the main components of the gas Junkers calorimeter are: first is the Bunsen burner. This is the Bunsen burner. Gas burns through the Bunsen burner. Second one is the gasometer, which controls the volume of gas, which is in turn burned into the gas calorimeter. And third one is the pressure governor, which controls the pressure of the gas pass through the Bunsen burner. And fourth one is the gas calorimeter. Gas calorimeter actually contains these vertical flues where the gaseous fuel burns, and these vertical flues are surrounded by the water heating spaces. This is the water heating space. Clear? And this water heating space contains two outlets. One is for the water inlet and second one is the water outlet. At both ends, thermometers are placed which reads the temperature of the incoming water or the outgoing water. These water heating surrounding space are then surrounded with the chromium plated jacket. This chromium plated jacket prevents the heat loss through the radiations. So this is the construction of the Junkers calorimeter. Now, working of the Junkers calorimeter. The burning of the gaseous fuel is continued at constant rates for about 15 to 20 minutes. When the gases burn, now gases are passed from this gasometer to this Bunsen burner. Now gases burns here. Known volume of gas is passed through gasometer to the Bunsen burner, and known volume of gases are burned at this place. When the gas burns, the heat is liberated and produces large amount of energy with the combustion products. The liberated heat is absorbed by this water. The liberated heat energy increases the temperature of the surrounding water and the combustion product escape through the waste gases at the base of the apparatus. These combustion products get outside from this pathway and this. Water gets condensed over here at the bottom of the apparatus. The temperature of the exhaust gases also noted from here. We can note down the temperature of the exit gases. The amount of steam formed due to the combustion is condensed at this end. Now, the amount of steam after combustion can be determined from here. Again, I am repeating the procedure. First of all, the known volume of gaseous fuel is passed through this Bunsen burner and the gaseous fuel start to burn here. During burning or the combustion reaction, we know whenever the fuel, any type of fuel, chemical fuel basically, burns, there is the combustion, formation of the combustion products. The major combustion products are the carbon dioxide and water, and with these combustion products a large amount of heat energy also released. So these carbon dioxide and H2O escape out from here. This, during this escaping, the H2O, which is actually generated in the form of steam, is now condensed and collected over here. So total steam is condensed and collected here. So we can measure the total amount of water formed by the collected amount of the steam produced. Now, the heat energy releases during the combustion reaction, it is get absorbed by this water and the temperature of the water increases. We can note down the final temperature of the water from this thermometer. This is the final temperature and we may call it T2 degree centigrade. So this is about the procedure of the Junkers calorimeter. Now coming towards the observations, we know that volume of the gas burned at STP in certain time is VML. We know how much amount of volume we pass through the gasometer. So this is the total amount of gaseous fuel burned. Weight of water in calorimeter, we have this value, capital W gram. Mass of steam condensed, M gram. From where we get it, mass of steam condensed? This is total amount of steam produced which get condensed at the bottom of the apparatus. This is the small m. And water taken in the calorimeter is the capital W, and the volume of gaseous fuel taken is the VML. So these are our observations, and the initial temperature T1 degree centigrade, final temperature T2 degree centigrade. Suppose the HCV of the gaseous fuel is L kilocalorie per meter cube. HCV is the L kilocalorie per meter cube. That means unit volume of gas releases L energy, L kilocalories. If unit volume of gas releases L calories, then total volume releases how much amount of energy? Yes, right. It is the V into L, because L is the amount of energy releases by per unit volume of the gaseous fuel, and total volume we have taken VML. So total amount of energy releases by combustion reaction is the VL, V multiplied by L. This is the total energy liberated. This total liberated energy is absorbed by the water. So we can calculate the heat absorbed by water by this way: weight of water multiplied by specific heat of water multiplied by rise in temperature. So we know that specific heat of water is 1 calorie. So the formula is capital W T2 minus T1. Equation number 2. We know that total amount of liberated heat energy is finally absorbed by the water. So equation number 1 must be equal to equation number 2. That's for VL is equal to capital W T2 minus T1. And L is finally capital W T2 minus T1 by V kilocalorie per meter cube. This is the HCV of our gaseous fuel. Now, how can we calculate the LCV from this equation? We know that mass of steam condensed per meter cube of gas is m by v. M is the total mass of steam produced. If we want to calculate per meter cube how much amount of steam is produced, then we have to divide it by the total volume of the gaseous fuel. So that's why the mass of steam condensed per meter cube of gaseous fuel is equal to m by v, and latent heat is equal to the total mass of steam produced multiplied by the latent heat of 1 mole of water, that is the 587. So to total latent heat is equal to the m by v multiplied by 587 kilocalories. Therefore, we know that LCV is equal to HCV minus latent heat. That's why LCV is equal to HCV minus m by v multiplied by 587 kilocalorie per meter cube. This is the final formula for LCV in the Junkers calorimeter. Now, what about the corrections in the Junkers calorimeter? We have seen various corrections in the Bohm's calorimeter, but in Junkers calorimeter, not so much corrections are there. For obtaining the correct value of HCV and LCV, the recorded volume should be corrected to the STP by measuring the atmospheric temperature and pressure. This is the only one correction in the Junkers calorimeter. So that's all about the determination of calorific value by Junkers calorimeter. Now, theoretical determination of calorific value by Dulong's formula. According to Dulong, the calorific value of a fuel is the sum of the calorific values of its constituents. That means total calorific value of any type of fuel must be equal to the sum of the calorific values of its components, its constituents. For example, if we consider the fuel which contains carbon, hydrogen and sulfur, so we know that for the carbon, unit mass of carbon, the calorific value is 8080 kilocalorie per kg. For hydrogen, 34500 kilocalorie per kg. For sulfur, 2240 kilocalorie per kg. These are the calorific value of individual these elements. So if we want to calculate the calorific value of the fuel which contains constituents carbon, hydrogen, sulfur, or any one of them, or any two of them, or all of three, then according to Dulong, calorific value of fuel is sum of the total calorific value of all of these elements. But one problem is there: if the oxygen is also present in the fuel, it combines with the hydrogen to form H2O. We know that hydrogen present in the fuel reacted with the oxygen and form water. But if some oxygen is already present in the fuel, then this oxygen which is present in the fuel consumes the hydrogen and convert it into H2O. That means it consumes some hydrogen, and now total amount of hydrogen available for combustion reduces. Why reduces? Because some of the oxygen present in the fuel consume hydrogen. That's why total available hydrogen for combustion get reduced. The hydrogen which is combined with the fuel's oxygen is called fixed hydrogen. Clear? Now, how can we calculate this fixed hydrogen? Let us see. Amount of hydrogen available for combustion is equal to total mass of hydrogen, that is total amount of hydrogen present in the fuel, minus hydrogen combined with the oxygen, that means oxygen which is present in the fuel, right? If we know if we write the molecular weight of these, we know that hydrogen's molecular weight 2, water 18, oxygen 16. Clear? If we divide all of them by 2, then 1 gram of hydrogen combines with how much amount of oxygen? 8 gram of oxygen to produce 9 gram of water. That means the hydrogen combined with oxygen is the 1/8 part of the oxygen available in the fuel. You can see here the oxygen and hydrogen reaction ratio is the 1:8. That means the hydrogen which reacts with the oxygen available in the fuel is the 1/8 part of the oxygen. We can write it as O by 8. This O by 8 is the amount of hydrogen which reacts with the oxygen present in the fuel. So we can say this is the fixed hydrogen which is not available for the combustion. Why it is not available for the combustion? Because this reacts with the oxygen already present in the fuel. So it is not taking part in the combustion. So finally, to get the available hydrogen for combustion is equal to total amount of hydrogen, which is called H, minus fixed hydrogen, which is the O by 8. So this is the amount of hydrogen available for the combustion reaction, H minus O by 8. This. Clear? So final Joulomb formula for calculating the HCV is equal to HCV is equal to 1 by 100 8080 carbon plus 34500 H minus O by 8, that is the hydrogen for combustion, plus 2240 sulfur kilocalorie per kg, where the carbon, H, O and sulfur, these symbols are the percentage of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen and sulfur in the fuel. Since these are in the percentage, that's why we are dividing here it by the 100 to get the final calorific value. For example, let us consider the solved numerical here. Calculate the gross and net calorific value of a coal sample having carbon 81%, hydrogen 8%, oxygen 4%, sulfur 4.5 and ash 2.5%. Clear? So by putting all these values, 8080 we know carbon value and carbon percentage is 81. So we are putting here the 81, 3450 hydrogen value. Then H minus O by 8, H percentage is 8, O percentage is 4 by 8, plus 2240 sulfur, sulfur percentage is 4.5. So by putting all these value, we get the amount of HCV. And NCV is calculated as GCV minus 0.09H into 587, and H is the hydrogen percentage. So we are putting here the 8 here, and final formula, final value of the NCV is 8810.46 kilocalorie per kg. Clear? Now, let us revise what we have learned in today's lecture. In today's lecture, we have learned about the determination of calorific value by Junker's calorimeter, in which we have detailed discussion about the construction, working of the Junker's calorimeter and observation and calculation of HCV and LCV by Junker's calorimeter. Then we have started with the determination of calorific value by Joulomb's formula, in which we have learned about the concept of the fixed hydrogen and the hydrogen available for combustion. So now time for learning check. Please read the numerical carefully. Pause the video and try to solve this numerical at your own. A coal has following composition by weight: carbon 90%, oxygen 3%, sulfur 0.5%, nitrogen 0.5%, ash 2.5%. NCV of coal was 8490.50 kilocalorie per kg. Now, calculate the percentage of hydrogen and its HCV. Try to do this numerical, and in next class or live class, we will solve it, or you come with the solution or the answers of this numerical. Thank you. Take good care of yourself and keep enjoy e-learning at home. Thank you.